probably the worst possible after dinner speaker or after lunch speaker, because what I'm going to talk about is a plague that is so grotesque that it's actually almost unbelievable. It's called stunting. Stunting means that an individual neurologically, physically, or economically never reaches their potential. Never. Remember the word never. They never recover from it. It's not like you have a bad cold and you get better. Stunting is a plague that affects more or less 37% of the rural population of Africa, 52% of the rural population of India, and 7% of the United States. So the numbers are staggering. And the idea of having generations of people who are stunted is really pretty much unacceptable. So what is the source of all life? And the answer will be, if it clicks on, let's hope the video works, it's making food crops more nutritious, because it's not caloric. India has plenty of calories, it's just not nutritious. And so what I'd like to do is take you through as quickly as possible. This is what I do. I look at plants at large scale, both molecularly. I have a big lab at Davis, I have one in Indonesia, I have one in West Africa, all around the country. So I look at millions of plants a year. But it all starts with a seed, and I don't know if anybody in this room knows what the seed is. Raise your hand. It's usually zero. So this is at 2 days old. And this is what it looks like at around 2 months. Still, maybe someone from California might guess this tree. And then at 2,000 years, it starts to look like this. Yeah, so this is General Sherman. It weighs as much as 6747s. It's off the beaten track. You're not allowed to go to it because they don't want people surrounding it and stomping the roots. But all of that information was in that seed, which weighs 1/600th of a gram. So yield's the issue. Yield's the game. It's not just nutrition. If you don't have yield, it doesn't work. But yield is simple. And if you look at this picture, on the left-hand side is teosinte. On the right-hand side is modern corn. Imagine the amount of information that had to change to go from teosinte to modern corn. Teosinte is the progenitor of all corn in the world. So there's something to be said. And originally, people judged plants on this kind of basis. They won prizes at the Iowa State Fair when they had the best, most beautiful corn. But that's not enough anymore, and here's why. Here's what we get to look at now. This is all about the power of 10. A kernel, very simple information, mostly endosperm. It goes from there, as you can see, to endosperm, a single cell. And it goes from there to the next phase so that we can see now easily, condensed chromosomes. And then we get to scaffolds, which hold it all together, just like a mechanical device, histones. And finally, we get to DNA. So today, we can go that far down and understand the information that's available to us to breed more nutritious plants. That shouldn't happen again. Let's go by. So we have to double the amount of food by 2040 in the world. And we're already operating on 1 1/4 planets on Earth. So there's almost no way that this is going to happen. It's certainly not going to happen just because we wish it to happen. But nutritional optimization is probably the most important thing we can do. So all seed is basically endosperm. And when you look at endosperm, it's what we're trying to improve. Proteins, starches, vitamins, micronutrients. But no one breeds for those things. They breed for yield and a little bit for disease resistance. So the outcome of this is grotesque malnutrition caused from chronic hunger. Mal is bad, and you know what the nutrition word means. So it's bad nutrition. Imagine that your whole headset is about bad nutrition. So if you look at carrots, what do you get from carrots? Well, that was an easy one. But actually, it's more important. We'll skip carrots for a minute. You actually get other things. But if you look at green vegetables, you get folate. Here's a hemoglobin that looks like the way you want to look at it, with iron in there. And here's a normal red blood cell colony. But here's what it looks like when you don't have iron in your diet. That's what a fatigue cell looks like, fatigued blood. And for other types of greens, you need iodine. Iodine stops cretinism. This is what cretinism causes in people. And I can go on and on through a different series of plants, and every one of them will offer you something that is unique. Now, this problem of stunting doesn't start when you're born. It starts in the mother's pregnancy, and it actually starts probably 12 months before the pregnancy itself. But if you look at what folate does, it's critical for neural tube development. Nuts, which grow everywhere in the world, outside of the problem with aflatoxin, give you zinc, which helps to overcome stunted growth. Remember, neurologically stunted, physically stunted, and economically stunted. So you're not going to be Yasha Heifetz, you're not going to be Bill Gates, you're not going to be Usain Bolt, you're just not going to be those people. And 300 children every hour die because of this problem. Stunting will kill you as well as other diseases. So our goal is to improve nutrition, make plants better. And the way we went about it was I formed this group called the African Orphan Crops Consortium. When I say formed, it was myself and Ibrahim Meyaki, the CEO of NEPAD, the development arm of the African Union. He said, do whatever you want to do. I think it's a great idea. Keep me informed. And we walked away. So what we did was we decided we were going to do this thing. And at the Clinton Global Initiative, we announced it. This is the opening of the Plant Breeding Academy, December 3rd. The gentleman in the center, I don't have a pointer, but between me and Tony Simons is the Minister of Agriculture from Kenya, welcoming the first 30 students to the Institute. It's men and women. We're training people in Africa with African scientists to go back to the African institutions that they work for. We're not coming in from the outside and determining what needs to happen. So we're going to do 101 genomes. So when I started in science, long before some of you were born, it was very clear to us that if you could work on one genome sequence in your lifetime, it was like just beneath the Nobel Prize. And that's all changed, because now we can take on 101 food crops simultaneously. This is the list. It's hard to read. The point is, it was a list that was determined pan-Africa by African scientists, African nutritionists, African food scientists, sociologists, cultural anthropologists said, fix these 100 crops and you'll go a long way towards fixing the rural sector of Africa. The first tree we're working on is baobab, 13.6 gigabytes, much, much bigger and much, much more complex than the human genome. Most of the plants are 2 gigabytes. So it's an enormous amount of information that is going to be generated in sequencing, assembly, and annotation. And why this one first? Because it's the icon of all Africa. And we were asked to do it by the African Union. It's an uncommon collaboration, which sounds like a corny term. But look at the list of people who were involved. None of them had ever worked before. None of them have ever collaborated, certainly not Life Technology and World Wildlife Fund, certainly not the iPlant and BGI. None of them have ever been brought together except when they were asked to collaborate on this project. There is no management to this project. There's no administrators to this project. It's a collective that's working together to do this project. And maybe I'll go back just for a second. Everyone has donated something in kind. BGI, 101 sequences. Life Technology, the IN Proton platform. 4 sequencers are set up at the World Agroforestry Center in a purpose-built space. The iPlant Collaborative is going to host all the data at the University of Arizona through the Texas supercomputer. Not a single penny has been spent on administration or anything like that. UC Davis is doing the Plant Breeding Academy, and we at Mars pay for all the teachers. So this is what happens. You start with your sequences, assemblies and annotations, 101 fully referenced genomes. You move very quickly to African scientists taking this information and then resequencing the local cultivars of the referenced genomes, maybe 150 times. So that means we will do as many as 15,500 full sequences. The amount of data really is staggering. I'm sure everyone in this room understands it. and I'm working with Google Earth Engine to try to build a couple pipes, a term I'd never heard before, to move the data to the cloud and drop it off in Arizona. Oh, I should go back. The highlight is everything's in the public domain. You cannot own this information. There's no way in hell you can own it. To access it, you go to a portal, you sign in and say, I promise not to patent these sequences, and you get full access. And everyone said this wouldn't work, but I did it with the Coco genome, and it worked perfect. We gave away, Mars Incorporated gave away the genome. It's been used by 250,000 scientists around the world as a model genome, and nobody complains that they can't own it. This is what happens when you breed in the public domain. And the most important thing, going through all these little funny words that some of you may or may not know, is the phrase at the bottom, this is sustainable society. And why do you do this? Because I cannot go to bed at night and think that African crop breeders working for the benefit of the citizens would not want to change the scenario of stunting in the world. So we've identified the 101 crops in Africa. We are getting ready to move forward with the 101 genomes. 26 will be done this year. It's all based on seed and roots and tubers. We're going to create optimally nutritious plants over the next 3 to 5 years to put it in place to improve the nutrition of an entire continent. That's my shot, my moonshot. And to end stunting as much as humanly possible based on what we can do as a small collective, a small collaboration. Thank you.